things, enviro typing and phenotyping for the component trait. The first part is very important, enviro typing. That is, the way you grow or the environment you grow, that decides what phenotype you see. So that's why, as I told in the slide, phenotype is G into E. So E plays very important role in many cases. This is an example I used to give in for my students. So this one is phenotyping for drought tolerance. So if you are screening your plants in the field, so this is 7 days of stress. I don't know whether you are able to see from there. So you see the plants are still green and they are turgid. There is no difference. You are unable to make that the plant is under stress. So here the plants are grown in pots and they are kept it in the net house. And within 3 days you see that the most plants are dried. Here it is, similarly the plants are grown in the pots and they are kept it in the greenhouse. And 7 days the plants are dried, but not to this extent. So the difference between these treatments, so all the three experiment, the student imposed stress to the plant. So he imposed stress for 7 days, but he did not see any effect on the plant. Here within 3 days, the plant is almost dead. Here after 7 days, the plant is under severe stress condition. So in all these cases, unless otherwise you characterize the environment, you will not be able to understand anything about the response of the plant. So if somebody says, I imposed stress for 7 days and then I studied the transcriptome of this leaf to identify genes, in these three cases, all three cases, you will find different set of gene expression. So this indicates the relevance of environment. So in this case, when you grow the plant in the soil, you will have a lot of water in the lower layer of the soil. So when you stop irrigation, the water, whatever the upper layer water is used, and then roots grow deeper and it takes water from the deeper layer. So still it maintains transpiration. So in this case, that opportunity is not there. It is in the pot. So whatever water is there in the pot, it is used by the plant. So after that, there is no water, it is dry. So in these two cases, the difference is that these plants are kept under open condition, these plants are under the greenhouse condition. So if people have entered any greenhouse, you will feel more humid, because here the humidity is high, the humidity is less. The difference between these two is, one of the differences is the vapor pressure deficit. That is, the air is more drier outside when compared to greenhouse. So that makes the rate of transpiration. And also if you see the amount of leaf area in this plant and this plant, you can see a significant difference. This plant has more biomass, it has more leaf area, so it can use more amount of water when compared to this plant. So all these differences you have to critically observe when you do phenotyping. And then you impose similar kind of stress to all the genotype for doing any experiment, whether you are doing a molecular experiment to study gene expression, or if you want to compare the genotype and rank the genotype for their stress tolerance. And also when we do field phenotyping, so sometimes like you see many experiment wherein they grow the plant and then after say 5 days of water withholding, they will write that I studied the gene expression or I did this transcriptome analysis. So it is not going to reveal the real situation which is in the plant, because if we impose different genotype to the stress level, depending upon the rooting depth, some genotype may not experience the stress, because it can, this line, if you see in the center line, it is very green, no stress is there. So it can take up water from the deeper layer. Whereas these genotypes, they will not be able to do that because of the shallow root system. So you clearly see there is a difference in the stress response. But if you study the expression of the gene difference between these two in the leaf, and if you try to correlate, then you will not find any correlation. You will find maybe identify thousands of differentially expressed genes between these two genotypes. And you will try to associate. So in this, if you study in these two, maybe all the photosynthesis and metabolic genes, they'll be over expressed here, but they will not be expressed here. So based on this kind of experiment, if you identify, if you do any analysis, molecular analysis, you are not going to get the correct results or the correct reasons for the same. And also the stress tolerance, depends upon the stage of the plant. In each stage, the plant has different ability to tolerate the stress. So these are different genotype grown in the field. So in this plot, you see that the leaves are very green. And here the stress, you can see that. But in this, if you see these plants, they are producing grain. In this, you see many white color here. So this is not because of this stress induces reproductive stage sensitivity. That is, this particular genotype is highly sensitive to reproductive stage stress tolerance. So this is unable to do fertilize and then set grains. So there will be a genotypic variation in the stress tolerance depending upon the stage in which the stress is imposed. So you have to see that if you are evaluating hundreds of genotype, you have to impose stress at similar phenological stage so that your comparison is uniform. So, and also these, in case of drought stress experiment, the soil is very important, and characterization of soil environment is very important, especially soil moisture content. So here two genotype example I have given. One is the Nagina 22 and another one is IR64. This is a highly drought tolerant variety and this is drought sensitive variety. So one experiment in two different experiment was conducted by different scientists and they reported this data. One person says that the relative water content of the Nagina 22 was reduced to 50% when the soil moisture content was 25%. In another experiment, the student, he reported that the soil moisture content was 20%, but there was no difference in the relative water content. You expect that in 25%, if there is some difference, in 20%, still the difference would be greater. That is, here it is almost near 90%. 90% means 90 to 100% they indicate good health of the plant, good water status of the plant. So in this case, what they failed to report is what is the kind of soil in which the experiment was conducted. So when you measure soil moisture content, if it is a clay soil, even at 25% soil moisture content, the available water will be very less. So how many of you from agriculture background? So all of you might have studied in your undergraduation what is available water, what is field capacity, and what is permanent wilting point. So when you irrigate the crop in different soil, they can hold certain amount of water in the microcapillaries. Only those water is available. Otherwise, water particle, water molecule can interact with the soil matrix, and it is tightly bound to the soil matrix. If it is bound to the soil matrix, the plant will not be able to extract that water. So in case of clay soil, maybe at field capacity, the water soil moisture content may be 50%, and permanent wilting point, that is the soil moisture at which the plant wilts, it will be about 25%. Whereas in case of the sandy loam soil or the kind of soil which is there in IRA, 20% means it is good. That is the field capacity soil moisture. So these two are soil types are different. So you have to know what kind of soil type you are doing. Like many people for doing meta-analysis or co-expression analysis, we take transcriptome data from different experiment. So we assume that the experiment was conducted in similar condition and we try to compare these data. So in those condition, if this kind of data is not available, the environment data is not available, it is difficult to comprehend anything from that. And also sometimes you see a confusing results in the literature, or when you do experiment also, you will find some these kind of results. So this student did an experiment where he has done a gene expression analysis to study what are the genes that of the proline biosynthesis pathway, how they are regulated between the tolerant and sensitive variety. And he also measured the metabolite content, that is the proline content, and the genes for proline biosynthesis. So in this experiment, he found that there was no difference in the proline content. He found both about 16-17 microgram of proline was accumulated per gram of fresh white tissue. Whereas in the transcriptome study, he found that the expression of genes for proline biosynthesis was higher in Nagina 22 and no difference in the catabolic genes. So then he was confused why there is a difference in the metabolite accumulation versus gene expression. Assuming that all the gene expressed is converted into protein, all the protein is active. So what could be the possible reason? Any of the physiology students, this is with reference to phenotyping. You don't think in terms of molecular term why there is gene expression is high and proline content is low. So any answer for plant physiology students from IRI? So when you do any stress experiment, you have to also know how to express your results, how to analyze your results. So in this case, he measured proline content. He took 1 gram of fresh weight and measured the proline content. And he calculated per gram of fresh weight what was the proline content. But if you see that, this is from the earlier previous slide experiment, the relative water content of these two genotypes were different at the time of sampling. Which means that if you take 1 gram of this tissue, the actual amount of cell will be less in this one when compared to the IR64. So you see there is a lot of difference in the relative water content. So here the student is taking more tissue per se. Here it is less amount of tissue, more of water it is. So if you express the same on the dry weight basis, then you see there is a difference in the proline content also. So you have to know how to analyze the data appropriately. So all these things I am explaining because we make most mistake in conducting the experiment. So the way you conduct the experiment, you get the data. And then we try to analyze and then we try to make some discussion. So everything is we make according to the data what we get. So to get proper data, we have to conduct the experiment properly. We have to measure all the environmental factors precisely and also the plant stage and the phenology, it should be similar for all the plants. So this is one of the famous example where the stress-induced transcriptome was analyzed. This is an Arabidopsis plant. They want to know what is the cold stress-induced transcription variation. So these are two experiments. Vogel et al., they conducted an experiment in Arabidopsis thaliana, and they found that about 900 genes are differentially regulated. That is 242 plus 674. So many genes are upregulated or downregulated with reference to 22 degrees Celsius. In another study, they also conducted a transcriptome analysis. They also found that about 800 genes are differentially regulated under cold stress condition. So in both the studies, the total number of genes that are differentially regulated under cold stress was about 800 to 900. So we assume that, the under cold stress, there are about 900 genes are differentially regulated. 800 to 900 genes are differentially regulated. But when they compared actual genes, they identified 900 decks and they compared whether the same deck was differentially regulated in the other experiment also. They found that only about 242 genes were common between these two experiments. Whereas majority, that is about 60% of the genes were not related to stress-induced gene expression. So this again suggests that the way you grow the plant and the way you impose the stress, so these details you will be hardly find in the manuscript, and we also don't give that much emphasis on how to grow the plant and how to impose the stress. So all those things make a lot of difference than the actual stress per se or actual the actual cause. So we have to be utmost, we have to take care of all these aspects for doing any proper experiment. And the next one is the temperature stress experiment. We conduct a lot of temperature stress experiment. We do gene expression analysis, or we compare any phenotype. So this is one of the experiment where the heat shock protein expression, how many of you know heat shock proteins? You might have studied, many people might have studied about heat shock protein. So it is a stress-induced protein. Under the heat stress condition, these proteins are synthesized. They act as a chaperon, and they protect the different proteins and give stress tolerance. So it is well known that if heat shock protein expression is there, it is going to give high amount of tolerance. So in this experiment, the experiment was conducted between a high temperature tolerant and high temperature stress sensitive genotype. And in the normal growth temperature, this is the base level expression, and stress condition, that is the student grew the plant and the plants were grown in pots and the pots were moved into the greenhouse or growth chamber, which is having 35 degrees Celsius. Then after some time he studied this, and then he found that the expression was high in 2329. So any reason for this? What could be the reason? Like, although this variety is tolerant, but it did not express this so much, whereas this variety is a sensitive variety, but it is producing more amount of heat shock protein. Although the reverse is true with reference to stress tolerance. So this one is a stress experiment, high temperature stress experiment. You are exposing the plant to high temperature. So these plants were grown outside, and these plants were taken and kept it inside the greenhouse or the growth chamber to impose temperature stress. So the student was not knowing about the ability of the plant to cool itself. That is, the plants lower their body temperature by using transpiration. So if water is available, the plant will do transpiration, and then it will cool its tissue temperature below the air temperature. If water is not there, the plant will not be able to cool. And also genotypes, they may have a different transpiration rate. So it is under similar conditions, some genotypes can reduce about 6 to 10 degrees Celsius. The temperature will be lower than that of the air temperature. If water is not available or some other genotype, it will have less reduction. That is, they will have less ability to transpire. So they will have less reduction in the temperature. Maybe possibility is that the student did not take care of the amount of water which was available in the pots. That is, the pots were not having the uniform soil moisture between this and this. Maybe this one was not having sufficient moisture, so it was unable to do transpiration and it maintained the transpirational cooling. So actually the tissue temperature difference was there between these two genotypes. So we have to take care when we are doing any temperature experiment, we should also measure the tissue temperature, especially when we are interested in the molecular level studies. Otherwise, if you are interested in yield and if you are doing some experiment, still you may get some results. But when we are doing molecular analysis to identify the causes, you have to be more cautious. So this shows what is the variation in the different genotype, how much variation can be there in the tissue temperature. It may be like 4 degrees less, yes, 10 degree less than the air temperature in different genotypes. This is a field is shown here, and the thermal image is taken. Thermal image is that infrared camera is used to take the image from the top of the field. And in this field, cotton plants are there, so they are doing transpiration. So if they are doing a good amount of transpiration, the canopy temperature will be less, which is shown in the blue color. If the plant is not doing transpiration, then it will have tissue temperature high, and which are highlighted in the red color. So these are the same genotype is grown, and each strip is one irrigation treatment. So we should suppose to see that each strip should have uniform canopy temperature. But here it is not seen because of the variation in the field. So in the field, a lot of field variation is there. That's why we do a lot of replication to minimize the experimental error. So in this case, if we grow different genotypes, say if you are doing in this field, if you are doing a drought experiment, we are screening maybe about 300, 400 germplasm line. So we put different genotype. We arrange 3 lines, 4 lines. So whatever the genotype which falls in these kind of plots, where you see the dark blue color, so those genotype will have less water, less yield reduction, because in those place maybe soil has more amount of soil storage capacity, or the field level is little bit low, so soil moisture is more. Whereas in this kind of plant where the plot is little bit higher and water storage is less, so those plots will have more stress level. So irrespective of the genotypic ability, because of the variation in the field, you will ultimately rank the genotype as tolerant and sensitive. So that's why field experiment require multiple years of repetition. So this is what, that is why we have to do precise phenotyping in the correct environment. That is, in the G into E, we have to give very important emphasis on the E component of G into E when we do phenotyping. And phenotyping is also, the component rate is also very important, because if you just measure yield or quality, which is ultimate product, we will not be able to know what is the, what are the genes or genomic region that contribute to the, that ultimate product. So yield per se, it can be contributed by various, like from gene level, maybe all the genes may be involved, and then trait level, maybe certain number of traits are there, and then it will lead to some yield component and the ultimately yield. So this, as I told earlier, several genotype can produce same yield, but they will have different differences in the pathway level or component trait level or yield component level. So that's why we have to identify what is the difference at the gene level, so that we can assemble, like in one genotype has a variation here, and another genotype, if it is having variation in the some other gene, and if you put together these genes, they may get better yield response. So that is shown in this particular graph. So if you do normal phenotyping, we measure yield or biomass at the end of the season. That is, at the time of maturity, we measure. So here, for three different genotype, when we measure the biomass, all produce same biomass. But if we can measure the biomass at different stage of the plant growth, we find there is a lot of difference. So it suggests that if you want to increase the biomass beyond this level in genotype, you have to assemble the genes which are involved in the biomass accumulation. Some genotype produces early vigor it has, so it accumulates biomass more. Some genotype pick up later, that is after maybe about 80 days, it start accumulating higher amount of biomass. So if you combine all this trait, they will be producing a genotype which perform, outperform everything. So this, in summary, phenotyping, and phenotyping at different stages of plant development, and phenotyping precisely in different environment with precise environment management is important. So that is what limiting the phenotype, genotype, estimation of phenotype, genotype relationship. Since the genotyping is easy now, and phenotype data is very hard to obtain, it takes a lot of labor, time, and space. There is a phenotype, genotype bottleneck. To solve this bottleneck, the new science of phenomics came in. This is an example where the importance of phenotyping at different stages or multiple time points of plant growth and development is emphasized. So the genome of a genotype, it is constant throughout the different tissues and cells, it will have the same genome. But if you see the epigenome, it will be different. That is, each tissue, each environment, it induces some variation in the genome. It may be DNA methylation, or it may be histone modification that leads to and epigenome, that is the part of genome that is expressed under given environment. So environment modifies the genome to produce epigenome, and then epigenome gives rise to different home and ultimately genome. So in each stage, there is a lot of interaction of environment with a different home. That's why it affects the development of phenome. So that's why multiple time phenotyping during the growth and development is important to capture all the genotypic variation in the phenotypic trait in the germplasm or in the breeding population. So that's why now phenotype is known as the king and the heritability is queen. So if these two are there, then only you can produce better crops. Conventional phenotyping is time, labor and space intensive. So if you want to know the biomass of the plant, say after 15 days or 20 days, what is the difference in the biomass? So you have to cut the plant, then you will dry it and weigh it. So it will take about 3-4 days, and also you lose the plant. And only the replica of the same genotype is studied in future for knowing the performance. And also, if you want to know the nitrogen content or protein content, it takes a lot of days. So it will take about at least about a week to know the nitrogen content. So this is very slow process, and it is difficult to do it at multiple time points in the crop growth period, and also difficult to do it for large number of genotypes. That's why the sensor-based phenotyping is important, wherein within a minute you can take the images, and then you can predict the you can measure the phenotype. So that's why the sense of the science of phenomics came in. You might have studied that the genome and genomics terminologies came from the Human Genome Project. Similarly, the terminology of phenome also came from the Human Genome Project, wherein in one of the meeting they once finished the genome sequence, they thought what to do next. Then this terminology of phenome was coined. Phenome refers to the phenotype as a whole or full set of phenotype of an individual. So unlike genome, it is very difficult to obtain the whole phenome of the plant, because we have limitation in the measurement of all the phenome that can be produced by a genotype. So some of the phenomics data can be acquired by the sensors. So since about last 10-15 years, the science of phenomics came in, and people are thinking that it will help in breeding for enhancing the productivity or enhancing the genetic gain what we are getting today. So next part of my talk is on the sensors per se. So most of you have, all of you have visited the facility, and you have got exposure to the facility. So you know what is genomics and how it works. So in brief, I have given some principle for most of the sensors which we use in genomics. So how many of you have measured some analyte in the laboratory, any protein or chlorophyll or some molecule in the laboratory? So most of the people might have measured something in the laboratory by using a spectrophotometer. So the principle of spectrophotometer is that you keep an analyte in a cuvette, and then light is passed, and then analyte absorbs some amount of light. Depending upon the chemical nature of the analyte, it will absorb certain wavelength, and the rest is transmitted. So in each wavelength, if 100 photons are going, or 100 micromoles of light is going in each wavelength, some is absorbed and some is transmitted. You measure the amount of transmitted light, and then you try to correlate that with the analyte concentration. So in case of the phenomics also, the sensor used in the phenomics, they also operate in a principle which is somewhat similar to this principle, wherein the solar radiation or artificial light source is used to illuminate the plants, and some of the light is absorbed in different wavelengths, some is transmitted and some is reflected.
So in all the sensors which we use in the phenomics, in most of the sensor, we use the sensor that can capture the reflected light. From the reflected light, we try to establish the phenotype. That is, from the reflected light, we try to measure what is the total volume of the plant, or what is the protein content of the leaves, depending upon the sensor which we use. So we assume that most of the light is absorbed, and only some part of the light is which is not absorbed is reflected. So I will, next slide I will show what are the sensors that operate on this principle. And we also use another principle of radiation emission. That is, every object above absolute temperature may emit radiation. This radiation, if we measure, we can calculate the tissue temperature. That is, if we measure the radiation emitted from our body, we can easily calculate the tissue temperature. So this principle is used in the infrared thermal imaging. And also the laser imaging is also used in the phenomics, wherein the laser light is projected from the source, and the laser light falls on the object, say for example on this chair, and the light is reflected back. So depending upon the reflected light, it calculates the shape of the object. So this is very useful in the biomass estimation. So most commonly used sensor in the high throughput plant phenotyping or next generation phenomics are these kind of sensor. That is, the sensor which can capture the fluorescence, or it can capture the visual light, which is like normal camera which we have in our phone, and normal camera which we use. So that is the RGB camera, which captures the wavelength from 400 to 700 nanometer. Or the near infrared camera, which captures the reflectance in the range of 700 to 1700 nanometer. In the hyperspectral cameras, it captures the reflectance from 400 to 2500 nanometer. Only difference between NIR and this camera is that here the reflected light is captured as a single point, that is 700 to 900 nanometer, whatever reflectance is coming. So that is captured as a single unit. That is, we will not be knowing what is the reflectance and in 800 nanometer, 900 nanometer, nothing like that. So it gives the whole reflectance in the entire range. Whereas in the hyperspectral cameras, you get the reflection data for each nanometer. So it is like more precise, you get lot of data, so it is more useful for lot of on-light measurement. The infrared thermal cameras are used for measurement of the tissue temperature, and the chlorophyll fluorescence camera is used to measure the photosystem efficiency. And the sensors, they come in either like the cameras, or they come in as also radiometric sensors. So these kind of sensors, they are relatively cheaper when compared to the sensors which are image based sensor. Radiometric sensor is like you will have a probe, just like if you focus on the object, whatever the reflectance is captured back by the sensor. So in this kind of sensor, there is only one point of data collection. That is, all the, depending upon the field of view, whatever the light is reflected, it is captured at a single sensor point. So here the sensors are in throughout the chip. So the each area or each pixel is covered as different point. Here the entire from the entire object, whatever the reflectance is coming, it is collected at single data source. So in this course, source, you will not be able to find out what is the reflectance from the soil or leaf or pot. So whatever it is, you take an average value. But in this case, once the image is obtained, you can process this image so that you can see what is the reflectance from the leaf pass. That's why the image-based sensors are more useful, even though they are costly. So you have seen the phenomics facility for yesterday. It is a kind of system wherein the plants are grown in controlled environment, and images taken within the different imaging chambers. Alternatively, the these cameras, they can be put it placed in the field where a fixed the stand is there, and the camera can fix and it can move in the x and y direction. So it can move here like this throughout the field, and it can take image even in the field condition. Or you can use these cameras and the drone. You can take a image in the field. So this already you have seen this facility. You know what are the different cameras are there, and how the image is taken. So just in brief, one plant when it enters the facility, about 741 images are taken. So large amount of data is collected. We have about 1,200 parts. You might have seen the cars. And normally we take about 10 time point for each drop. So it is about 8.89 million images are collected. So much phenotype data is collected, and from this you get lot of information, pixel wise information you get. That is, it is not that for each plant you are getting only one data. So you get data pixel wise. So you know how much amount of data is being generated. So other thing you might have studied there, what each camera measures. So the visual camera, the whatever we have with everyone, it measures the shoot and root growth, or it measures the geometry, greenness, leaf area, whatever we see by our eyes. All these traits are measured, and these are these can be quantitative. That is, when we see by our eyes, we do visual scoring. But all this can be done quantitatively. That is, if large numbers of genotypes are growing, you can see in the field and say maybe this genotype is better and this is not better. But it is difficult to rank the genotype in short time. But if you take one image, it can be ranked, and the biomass growth, all the data can be obtained very quickly. So normally in the visual camera, you obtain the reflectance is collected in three wavelengths, red, green and blue. And this can be split into the color globe, how from the green, each pixel, how the value changes from green to red or from the black to white. Once the data is placed on the color globe, then it is easy to separate the plants and the background noise. So this is how the image is taken, and image is processed to obtain only the plant image. From this, various parameters are calculated, which you might have seen yesterday. So you can calculate the leaf area without doing all the destructive measurement. You take the image and you calculate the leaf area. Similarly, you can, from the image, you can calculate the chlorophyll content also. You need not do the chemical extraction and make the measurement. So it makes the data collection very easy, and it is accurate, and it is useful for later analysis. That is, the data is stored. Later, if you have some questions, you can take out that image and see what happens. So in case of NIR imaging, which measures mainly the reflectance in the NIR range, the water has to measure the absorption peak. So it measures reflectance is measured at this range, it can easily calculate what is the water status of the plant. So in this case, in our facility, the NIR system we have, it takes the image and then it calculates the relative water content, what is the water status of the plant. This is very important when you do any stress experiment. You should know the water status of the plant for exactly comparing the phenotype. The hyperspectral cameras are highly useful, as I told, because it measures in the wide range of wavelength, and you get the data for each wavelength. So this can be used for various biochemical measurement. As I told, the water status can be calculated from the reflectance at one or two wavelengths. And if you want to know the leaf nitrogen content, you can use red NDVI method, where this reflectance at these points are used to calculate the red NDVI. So these are different genotype I have shown. For example, they are grown under normal nitrogen content and nitrogen deficient content. So in this genotype, if you see, one is that under normal condition also you see some variation in the genotype in the amount of nitrogen in the leaf. If it is more green or blue, it indicates high level of nitrogen. If it is red color, it indicates low level of nitrogen. You can easily, after taking the image, you can quantify how many pixels are there in this, or how much leaf area is having good amount of nitrogen when compared to the other genotype. And also when you subject this plant to stress, and if you see this one, when under nitrogen deficiency is there, most leaves they turn into the pink color or red color. Whereas in this genotype you see that the still this genotype maintain a lot of greenness. So you can easily quantify this and put it in the quantitative terms. You can calculate the leaf nitrogen content. And there are a lot of people have done work, and they have shown that nitrogen content can be calculated by using this reflectance method. And also you can calculate other nutrients in the leaf tissue. This is phosphorus, potassium, magnesium, calcium and sulfur. Many nutrients can be calculated from the reflectance value. But in for each crop you have to do one experiment wherein you measure the actual the chemical composition by the conventional biochemical method, and then you do reflectance and you develop a model to predict the trait of your interest. So in another study they have about 13 elements they could detect by using the hyperspectral reflectance. You can also measure the protein content by hyperspectral reflectance. So this is the spectral data of reflectance from 2000 to 2500 nanometer, and these are the different genotype. Each genotype has one own line it is shown. So this shows lot of variation in the reflectance. And this reflectance data was used to calculate, establish a model to predict the protein content. That is, this shows the relations between the protein that is measured in the lab versus the protein predicted based on the reflectance data. So you can easily measure the protein content in the grain without doing all the destructive work which require a lot of time and labor and cost. And also you can see within the grain where how the protein is distributed. Interestingly, you can see that in some genotype the distribution of protein is in the germ or in some other region, whereas in some genotype the distribution is uniform. Here the values which are shown in black color, that is the predicted, and this one is the actual value. So almost you see the similar amount of protein is predicted. And you can also see the variation between the genotype within the grain. This kind of data is highly useful for genome-wide association analysis, and they examined whether the phenotype predicted by the hyperspectral method will be useful for estimating the establishing the genotype-phenotype relationship. So this is the NDSI measured, or the protein content measured by hyperspectral data. So they used this data for GWAS, and they mapped three different SNPs in the genome for protein content. And this is the actual protein content measured. So this data was used for map the GWAS was done to map the position. And in both the cases, if you see this and these two locations, they came in common. So it suggests that this is better than the actual protein content measurement per se. Besides the protein content, various other traits can be measured. This example I have shown, it is for mainly for the harvesting of grapes. So this is a grape orchard, and if you take the spectral image, from the spectral image you can calculate how much is the TSS accumulation and what is the accumulation of the anthocyanin, and you have to harvest the grapes at appropriate TSS and the anthocyanin. So just you run the machine through the vineyard, and then you can decide what time the grapes will be harvested. This is an example where you can measure the sugar content in the leaf, water soluble sugar content in the leaf. So various biochemical component can be measured by using hyperspectral imaging. So the next one is the chlorophyll fluorescence imaging. So when light falls on the chlorophyll, it is converted into like biomass through light reaction and the Calvin cycle reaction. So it, the light produces certain energy which is used in the mixing of carbon dioxide. So if there is the light harvesting complex or the electron transport system is healthy, the amount of fluorescence emission is less and all the energy is converted into photochemistry. If there is any stress, so the photochemistry, if it is affected, the heat emission and fluorescence emission increases. So the healthiness of the electron transport system can be measured by saturating the photochemistry quickly, and then if you measure the amount of fluorescence, the healthy leaf will show more fluorescence when compared to the damaged system. So that is what is used in the chlorophyll fluorescence measurement. So wherein the plant is dark adapted, that is it kept it in dark for about 15 to 20 minutes. This opens up all the electron acceptor component in the electron transport chain, and then the base level fluorescence is measured. After that, a saturating pulse of light is given. It is maybe about more than 5000 micromoles of light is given in a flash. So that is sufficient to saturate all the component, and the excess light is emitted as fluorescence. That is the maximum fluorescence. So if you measure the difference between the minimum fluorescence, maximum fluorescence versus minimum fluorescence divided by the maximum fluorescence, the value is about 0.85. So that is for any healthy system, that value comes out to be about 0.85. And as the stress increases, the value decreases. So that can be measured by using the fluorescence imaging. So this is for an example, two different plants are grown in the same pot and subjected to drought stress. And the plant which is tolerant to drought stress, it maintained electron transport activity, whereas the plant which is sensitive, it is unable to maintain electron transport activity. The additional system which we have for measuring indirectly the photosynthesis and the water uptake of the plant is the thermal imaging. So as I told earlier, the thermal imaging, depending upon the radiation emission, and this is shown here, what is the relation between the temperature and radiation emission. So if you measure the amount of radiation emission, we can easily calculate what is the temperature of the plant. It has almost one-to-one relationship between the radiation emission versus the temperature. So you can calculate the temperature of the plant, not only the whole system, but also you can see what is the temperature of the panicle, what is the temperature of different leaf. So everything can be calculated for more precise study. The final component in our facility is the system to measure water use efficiency. So traditionally, it is impossible to measure water use efficiency in the field condition, because when you irrigate, you don't know how much water each plant is taking and doing transpiration. So normally, the lysimeter system, or the plants are grown in pot, and these pots are daily weighed to calculate the water use efficiency under open condition. So it is not in the shown in directly in the soil, but the pots filled with soil where the plants are raised, and daily you measure the pot weight in the morning and the evening to see how much amount of water is used by the plant. So this is highly laborious, and that's why this trait is not exploited in the breeding program so far. So far only one or two QTLs have been mapped, that too in Arabidopsis, not in the higher plant. So we have in the Phenomics facility for weighing and watering, wherein you can precisely weigh the pot daily or whatever time you want, and then you can irrigate the plant. So in this case, you can also calculate the amount of biomass, that is, as the plant grows, the biomass increases, so you can do all the calibration or all the corrections for increasing the biomass in the weighing and watering system. So all this camera you can also put in the drone and you can take an image. So maybe in the field within 5 minutes, maybe your entire field will be covered by the drone. And this data can be used to calculate various growth parameters. This shows the calculation of biomass for different genotype and different treatment conditions. So this is nitrogen deficiency condition, this is normal condition, and this is drought stress condition. If it is more blue, it indicates more biomass, and as the color changes from here to here, it indicates change in the biomass towards lower side. So you can clearly see the biomass variation between different genotype. So you quickly take the data, and this data is available or permanent data which can be used later for any kind of analysis. So besides these sensors which I have discussed with you, there are other kind of sensors people are trying to develop. So everybody, I think, I don't know whether you people see, but it is all the old people, they will have mobile, and every time they will take out the mobile and see how many steps they have walked or what they have done. So some gadgets we have to know how many steps we have walked or how many calories we have burnt. So similarly, if we can have some gadgets that can be attached to the plant, and then it will tell about the plant health status. Those that work is in progress. Some sensors are developed. This is plant tattoo sensor, which is a thin sensor which can be fixed to the leaf. It is very, very thin, just like a sellotape, it can be fixed to the leaf. And then it will conduct the data about the plant water use. Or another kind of sensor, thin film metal strain sensors are there, which can be fixed to the plant, and it will continuously tell about the growth. So it may be growing in sub-millimeter rate per minute. Those data can be easily captured. So these are being developed in a large. So there is lot of interest in the recent startup program of the Government of India. Many IIT graduates, they have come up with project to develop image-based solution for precision agriculture. That is, use different kind of images to take this predict plant health status, and then tell the farmers whether to irrigate or to give nitrogen application or to spray pesticide. Or there are options are available wherein the pesticide spray can also be automated. That is, in the drone itself, you will have automated sprayer. If it senses that in a specific location a pest or disease is there or nitrogen is less, it can apply the inputs also. So that's all in brief about the phenotyping and phenomics. So the most important slide in the presentation is this one. It is the question that gets you the Nobel Prize. After that you add lab coats, coffee and air conditioning. What I mean to say is the research question which you ask, the way you conduct experiment is going to decide. Even if you don't have state-of-art facilities, you can do better, you can do wonderful research. Only thing is you have to read well, read the literature well, and you decide your experiment precisely, ask correct research question, then you will have a better research output. So finally, I thank a large number of my colleagues who are involved in the development of the genomics facility. So most importantly, I thank our Director General. You might have heard him on the first day of inauguration. So he was instrumental in establishing this facility. So the project started in 2011, and ultimately we took a lot of time to establish this facility, and now it is operational. So far we have collected more than 30 million data we have collected, and we are using it for improving the water use efficiency and stress tolerance in rice and wheat. So thank you. Although I took a little bit longer time, so I thought I will explain the earlier part. So if you have some questions, I can take up.
Okay. data or maybe in blocks to build from images, we can have the information about the field uniformity conditions and we can make the blocks accordingly.
Yeah, it can be done. So far, like in the when the crop is not there, the soil images can be used for say if you want to know the soil moisture content in the field, whether it is uniform or not, or some of the other soil biochemical the soil chemical parameters can also be estimated from the imaging. So that can be used for blocking, or at least you when you place your genotype, you see that the experiment is done properly. It is useful.
Sir, regarding different soil moisture conditions, different soil moisture conditions mean drought and what flooding condition. In drought, the set of genotypes will give some different traits, and in flooding condition, they will show some different types of traits. And particularly in maize, I'm doing.
Okay.
In drought condition, the sensens I observed from bottom to top, and in flooding condition, top to bottom. And how do we correlate that traits across the different conditions?
In case of water logging, so I don't know whether it is like top to bottom, because in case of drought, when the drought occurs, plant programs it water supply and try to make the older leaf, which are not highly productive, to senes or roll and dry. In case of water logging, the problem is the root activity is dead. That is, the root is killed under water logging conditions. So the water uptake per se is not there. Because of that, the whole plant wilting you find, because younger leaves are not having that much cellulose content. Their structure is weak. So that's why you see that it is coming from the top. But the whole plant wilting is possible. So this you can by imaging. Now you know that if it is water logging, the wilting starts from the top. So this information need to be used when you do image. Like wilting can occur because of various reasons. If there is a some disease, like any root rot or some wilt is there, that is also caused by a disease. So unless you should have all those information about the field, only just by taking image, you cannot say it may be because of drought stress or it may be because of water logging stress. That's why you should have all the data about environment. And when these data are collected, these metadata should be available with the image data. Then only it will be useful for deriving the meaningful information. So that inputs, as scientists, we have to give that input to the system. Or in case of if you collect maybe large amount of images, and if you train the machines under flooding condition, this kind of image is coming, under drought condition, this kind of image is coming, then later stage without human intervention, it can do the same thing.
Sir, in your experiment, that control and drought condition, there was, means how you impose that drought condition, means how you keep a space, because in that two plot, after giving water from control side, it moved to drought side also. So how you are dealing with that?
So in the field, if you are conducting experiment, depending upon the soil type, so if it is like clay soil, or if it is sandy soil or sandy loam soil, the percolation and seepage loss, water movement will be different. So if it is sandy soil, the percolation will be like more. Water you irrigate, it will go straight. So in that case, between the control and drought stress treatment, maybe the amount of space you leave, that is in one plot if drought stress is there. Another block, if you have a irrigated block, maybe if you leave about 1 meter space, it may be sufficient. But if as the soil heaviness increases, you have to leave more space. Or you have to use, like you have to make a trench and tarpaulin or polythene you have to put and then fill it with the, so that the seepage loss is minimized from one plot to another plot. So better this treatment you cannot do randomized block design for this one. You should have separate blocks, like one block you keep it entirely for irrigated treatment, another block for drought treatment, and see that sufficient space is there. Normally putting tarpaulin and other thing is also laborious. If you have a space, you can increase the space. Otherwise, if your space limitation is there, we have to put some barrier for water movement.
So in black soil, maximum if 2 meter space, if keep, it will be sufficient between blocks?
I think so. 2 meter space should be sufficient.
Sir, in another imaging condition, so if you have used a camera phone plus your camera phone and professional camera, and we have taken the frames, I have calculated through frames.
Okay.
So whether there will be difference in that frames and centimeter conversion?
Always you have to use, I think, some standard. If you use, it is better. Like normally, if you use some known area or known dimension, if there is in the when you do imaging, if you use an object with known dimension, it is easy to calculate later if you are interested in calculating the area, biomass, and all those things.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, I guess all of you might have enjoyed sir's lecture. Yes?
Yes.
So, just few of big thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for coming and giving the lecture.
Thank you.